Borderlands, Southern California. And at the end, we're going to save a little bit of time to answer some of your questions. So I guess we're just going to launch right into this.
But we should tell people this is a little awkward for us because we're very good friends. We've known each other for a long, long time.
It's true.
Pre-USC.
Yeah, pre-USC. We've been to many different places giving talks, sometimes together.
See, you're just being formal. I was going to say we mostly spend time in...
The athletic club.
Poorly lit bars and our gym. And our gymnasium.
Exactly.
Yes, so we're normally where we have a very high level, high caliber academic conversations.
Yeah, that's where all the work
gets
done.
That's where the work gets done.
That's really where all the work gets done. So I guess to start, I think that one of the things that we want to be talking about is LA, right? And whether or not it has any kind of real defining culture beyond that kind of Hollywood imaginarium sense of Los Angeles. What the rest of the country often thinks of as Hollywood, its glitz and plasticity.
Right.
And, you know, for me, and I think this is probably the same for you, is that, you know, I think of LA as always having been a place, a sanctuary for dreamers, of various migrants, whether or not it's from the East Coast, folks looking for a little more sunshine and a different way of living, to, you know, immigrants and refugees, you know, seeking a welcoming place to thrive and survive. So, I mean, I don't know, like, if you could say anything about, like, what is most defining for you about L.A. And most influential to your work, what would it be?
Well, first, I would agree with everything you just said. I mean, you know, when people talk about Los Angeles and when they conflate it with Hollywood, you know, Hollywood is a fairly recent development in the history of Los Angeles and the long narrative of LA, really an early 20th century kind of addition to Los Angeles that definitely changed LA for sure.
Oh, yeah.
And the industry still, if you're not involved in the industry in Los Angeles, even indirectly, it can impact you. But, you know, like in the class I'm teaching right now called To Live and Die in LA, you know, we don't focus on Hollywood, like, at all. Like, it pops in where it needs to pop in, but we really are kind of looking at Los Angeles as this kind of long and ongoing story of all of the things that you mentioned, of different waves of migration, of different battles for conquest and space, for kind of the relationship between the incredible cultural integration that Los Angeles always has in the face of tremendous social segregation. I mean, this is still a very segregated city, but historically it's always been a very segregated city. And the culture that's erupted out of that, I think, has been a kind of direct response to it. So in the projects I've done on Los Angeles and its history, particularly some stuff with the LAPL and the archives of Los Angeles Public Library, one on songs and one on restaurant menus, that was always the question, was like, well, is there like one song of LA?
Yeah.
Is there the ultimate LA menu? Is there one culture?
Ultimate dish.
Yeah, and there isn't. I think that is, as cliche as it might sound, that's why Los Angeles is Los Angeles, is that the only way to sum up this city is to not sum it up. I mean, the only way to sum it up is to go and through the dispersals and the multiplicities and the complete, you know, kind of explosion of diversity and difference that the city constantly represents. That's who we are.
Yeah. Well, and that's one of the things too that, like, I've always appreciated about Los Angeles is, like, most people really hate its centralistness and its sense of sprawl.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that what I find in its sprawl are some really interesting reparative ways that people have dealt with these neighborhoods being spread out and forming really strong neighborhood ties and communities and distinct characters and identities. And, you know, one of my favorite projects of yours is certainly the menu project. You know how much I love food.
You do?
Oh,
I wasn't aware of that.
Wait, you didn't know.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, because they never
eat
in front of
me. Do you like fried chicken?
I don't know. I'm really ambivalent about fried chicken.
I know, I can
but,
tell.
But, you know, one of the things that, one of the classes that I teach here at USC is a Maymester class, which is a special four-week experiential course on food culture.
It's like the class I always want to take.
It's what we do, a lot of eating, but it's on food cultures in on the West Coast, basically. But we spend our first 3 weeks in LA, you know, really kind of checking out the different forms of cuisine that have, like, grown and developed and cultivated in different parts of the city, mm-hmm. whether or not it's, you know, different sort of regional Asian cuisines in the San Gabriel Valley. We also take taco crawl using only public transportation, which is a really interesting way to experience the kind of sprawl of Los Angeles, and even, you know, check out the ecosystems of Catalina Island, where USC has a marine studies institute, and we learn.
Do you
about
swim to Catalina? Do you have to swim there?
We do a lot of swimming once we get there. The real bonding experience is when we all have to put wetsuits on together.
Yeah, which, you know, I imagine
it can be very stressful.
Bonding seems like a nice word.
Yeah, very bonding. Yeah.
It's interesting, the decentral stuff, because we're dealing with this a lot in my class also, where, you know, that is, of course, one of the great kind of headlines about LA is that we're, you know, a city with no center and da-da-da. And the more you dig back into the history of the city and its spatial geography, of course, you realize that the decentralizing of Los Angeles actually is because of communities being kicked out of their neighborhoods. Mm-hmm. So, like, the city grows from a from what was a totally old-fashioned core at the original plaza, and that core then all the communities that were there, the Mexicans who were there, the Japanese who were there, the Chinese who were there, start getting kicked out as things get built, and so then you have East Los Angeles growing, then you have South Los Angeles growing, and then when cars come in, you know, and the red cars go away, you've got Wilshire developing, and it in a way those headlines are really helpful, but they're also kind of dangerous, is that in that they erase all of the, in many cases, pretty ugly histories. You know, like right now we're talking about, and I know you have feelings on this because I don't know anything about baseball, but we're talking about Chavez Ravine right now and the Dodgers in the World Series, which is an amazing thing. I know people are very excited, but also
it's
like...
It's been 29 damn years.
29 years, right. But they're embedded, obviously, in that place is this kind
violent
of haunting.
History. Yeah. Absolutely. You know, and most of my first book actually spent a lot of time tracing the kind of newer iterations of that like set of movements in and displacements of communities who settled in neighborhoods like Silver Lake or Echo Park and even kind of Northeast Los Angeles. Yep. And so, and how that culture has really kind of commuted its way out to the suburbs and isn't just lost there once these communities move to these areas. That's why, you know, Los Angeles is a megalopolis in that sense, where a lot of the adjacent cities and counties and communities are very much feeding into or part of its broader culture.
Yeah. And if you go back like and look at the, you know, in the older and the kind of earlier version of Los Angeles, it was the, you know, as Eric Avila at UCLA has written about, you know, LA was a chocolate city with vanilla suburbs. And now, I don't know if it's a vanilla city with chocolate suburbs, but it's certainly chocolate suburbs.
It's definitely chocolate suburbs since about like the late 70s on.
Yeah.
So, and that's why I also find that region that, you know, the author Sandra Singh Lowe calls Lesser Los Angeles so fascinating and like so rich with different histories, particularly for people of color, LGBT people of color, who made lives in places that seem not amenable to those environments.
So,
usually.
And what I've always loved about your work and about your proclivities, cultural, cultural and otherwise, is your commitment to the Inland Empire, your commitment to the kind of greater geographies of what we might think of as LA, and not seeing a place like Riverside, let's say, as separate from Los Angeles, is actually part of what the what stories you need to tell. And, you know, and you your first book was really, I think, so instrumental for so many people in understanding the wider spatial geographies of the greater suburbs and empires around LA proper, but also, as you said, the way that those spaces became crucial sites of sustainability for migrant communities, queer communities, and sites of great pleasure.
Oh,
I mean, you
absolutely.
And I share that. We should front load that with our work,
right? We're talking really seriously right now, but so much of, I think, what drives both of us in our research and our teaching is really kind of asking questions about the things that have been intriguing to us, that have given us pleasure and joy. Whether or not it's the Dodgers or fried chicken or food. I know you love the Lakers.
I
Lakers
do.
Guy.
Still.
I know. You still. You're so
What's
loyal.
Up with that?
To the music, right?
Yeah,
and, you know, we have obviously overlapping interests
Absolutely.
In music.
Yeah.
But sometimes a real different kind of sides of the kind of musical spectrum that we both gravitate towards.
Let me actually on that. This is something that we've never talked about in public.
Yeah.
One of the things, not just our interest in music, but our I think our commitment, whether we like it or not, it's like in kind of it's in our DNA to find in music and other popular cultures an inherent sense of possibility, an inherent sense that music is a way for people to survive, for identities to be shaped,
for people to forge intimacies.
Exactly. And I remember a talk you gave, I don't know where this was, it's a conference we were at a long time ago, but it was for your first book, and it was you quoted the oh no, this is gonna be terrible. I'm in big trouble. It was the Smiths or the Morrissey line. There was a light that never goes out.
Yeah. The Smiths. Yeah.
And that sense, I remember in my head thinking like, oh, this is why Karen and I get along.
Is that's that the hook belief that drives me. Yes, right. There's a light that never goes out, and it is about the collaborations you make with people, the friendships you strike up, the friendship we've struck up over the course of many years together, and working together, especially at a place like USC, where we have a lot of occasions and opportunities to share that mutual like love and passion with our students and with the broader community.
What do you say? Someone said this to me over the weekend at a talk I gave. Asking if, and I get this actually a lot, and I'm sure you do too, is when someone accuses you of being romantic, what's your response to that? Are we over investing in the power of a song to change the world?
I think that most worlds have been changed by over investing, through our kind of strong and powerful emotional commitments to the things that stir, that move us, that spur us on to action, that sometimes make us angry, that sometimes make us sad, right? So I think that, I think that what we're investing in is not, it's not an overinvestment, but it's a kind of tapping into that space within that that generates that kind of activity and energy and that has the capacity to be infectious.
Yeah,
this absolutely is why I love karaoke so much.
That's right.
Even though I don't think, have I ever dragged you to karaoke? I don't think you've ever come with
me. I'm just going to go public here and say that Karen Tongson has never invited me to karaoke.
I always, you know what though?
Actually, Karen Tongson knows I go to bed at 9 a.m.
Exactly. Yeah, that's, okay. Yeah,
9 p.m.
exactly. But yeah. 9 p.m. or 9 a.m. Yeah. One of my favorite, and this is one of the things that I've been thinking a lot about because one of my favorite places in Los Angeles, the Smog Cutter, which is
closed,
in East Hollywood. It's closing on October 29th. So actually have
that's why you're wearing black?
That's why I'm wearing black. And I've been, I actually just wrote a piece for LA Weekly. It should be coming out this week about the bar's closing, a little bit about its history, which is so much about precisely what you're talking about, or what you talked about earlier with, these flows of different sort of migrants, immigrants, finding a place where at first they just kind of hung out, had some drinks, ate some food that the folks who owned the bar would occasionally dole out, and this young effervescent dude named Pete Gonzalez came and said, hey, in the 90s, he's like, let's do some karaoke. He's a Filipino-American guy. And from then on, it has sort of established itself as this real crossroads of, communities that might otherwise not get along or that might have conflict in other spaces in the world, but that, in that space of song and conviviality really make things happen.
And you have an endowed chair at the Smog Cutter, right?
It's sad that, of course the place where I do have an endowed bar stool is shutting down.
Excuse me. Well, that seems fitting.
It seems fair and fitting.
Yeah. What else should we talk about? We can talk about PST.
Oh, yeah. You've been doing so much stuff. You've got so many events and so many different styles of music.
It's been a busy fall. But it's connected to this thing that you're talking about, to that idea of the convivial, I think.
Yeah.
So Pacific Standard Time, LALA, the Getty Foundation's multi-million-dollar initiative funding exhibits at museums and galleries across Southern California, all on the theme of Latin America and Los Angeles. Mm-hmm. And for this round of it, I worked on a book. We did academic research on the history of Latin American music in Los Angeles, and then the challenge I put toward myself, which I'm not sure how I'm meeting it, we'll see how that goes, is to how do you turn a book of academic research into six concerts? Mm-hmm. And how do you do public music events
that are based
in research, mm-hmm. but are also, you don't have to, although I had this really ridiculous vision that people are going to go to a concert carrying a $25 University of California press book.
I would do that.
That's why we have two copies. And so we've done all these concerts, and we've had them around the city at the Getty Center, at the Hammer, at LACMA, and have one coming up actually on Thursday of this week that's totally free to everyone at the Downtown Palace Theater, one of the historic movie palaces in downtown Los Angeles. And we're recreating a Spanish language variety show from the 1950s. Yes, Variedad. And we're going to have dancers and musicians, and we're going to show an excerpt from a Spanish language Laurel and Hardy film. when they were El Gordo y El Flaco. We'll have that. That's been recently restored. And it's going to be a kind of celebration of that era of Spanish language entertainment, which isn't getting its due, in my opinion, as Downtown is being revived.
Yeah. You know. Well, it'll be interesting. I love that you're re-inhabiting one of these spaces that, you know, because a lot of those great theaters over the course of time were converted into basically electronics warehouses.
They were. It's true.
Selling, you know, TVs and, you know, things that maybe fell off trucks and that kind of thing.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, but that's something that just for me is really exciting and inspiring about being here and here at USC, here in Los Angeles, is access not just to the city, but access to the archival riches of the city. And, you know, like you, I think we both love informal archives more than we love formal archives.
You know, ones.
The old photographs, ephemera, T-shirts, ticket stubs, you know, things that you can then...
Buttons. Stuff from the swap meet.
That's it. Yeah. Right. And these are languishing in many cases. And so part of the challenge that I like to put for myself is like, how do you engage with those archives, curate them and present them publicly, and then bring them to life with contemporary artists and contemporary folks in the city in new ways?
No, absolutely. And you know, I know that I started off by kind of talking about how LA is not just Hollywood and the sort of film and television industry, but because I'm interested in what the film and television industry is doing to actually address some of these different ways that we've been looking at LA and these industries over the course of time, I'm going to plug an event that I'm doing here at USC on Wednesday, November 1st, and it's going to be at the Stark Family Theater in the Cinema School on the television series Unreal, Lifetime
A&E.
I'm going to be in conversation with Sarah Gertrude Shapiro, its co-creator, also my colleague and book co-editor Henry Jenkins, who's at Annenberg with you, is going to be part of the conversation with showrunners Stacey Ruckheiser, and we've got several of the main cast members coming through as well. So I hope you join us and kind of think about,
there.
You know, this place. Los Angeles is a place that creates different realities as much, you know, at the same, manufactures certain realities and like how those manufactured realities come into a real kind of conflict or contradistinction that's really going on.
I think both those events are good examples, though, of what we both do in our work, which is you're not just doing a night celebrating Unreal. It's not like a Paley Center event, which is, those are great.
Yeah.
But you're interested in a show like that for what it says about the industry, for what it says about gender, for what it says about reality. I mean, lots of other things,
reality,
I'm sure.
Reality, race, and sexuality.
Right. Absolutely.
It's going to be, and so, you know, I'm really grateful that these folks are willing to have a conversation with us. And that's one of the things, too, that I've noticed is that, you know, you probably noticed this as well. Like, if you just reach out to the kind of communities, the creative communities around us here in Los Angeles, this is what makes it so great to teach at USC. You know, we have an occasion to do that and to bring that here to our friends and colleagues and students.
Yep. And you do it also. I'll plug for you. You also are involved in a really great podcast these days, right?
I've been having fun doing this podcast. I do it weekly. It's called Pop Rocket.
Great.
And it's hosted by comedian Guy Branum, who hosts Talk Show, The Game Show. And I'm on a panel with Guy, Margaret Wappler, who's a great LA-based journalist, and digital strategist Winter Mitchell, who's amazing and fantastic. And we just have the occasion to talk every week about the pop culture we're interested in, our favorite jams of the week, and maybe a special topic. So it's also been a nice opportunity to, you know, take some of the conversations we have in the classroom and bring them into a broader sphere of, you know, chat and conversation and understanding.
And that's, again, I mean, we're a good pairing on this, is that something that I think both of us, on the one hand, of course, value deeply the experiences that we're a part of in our classrooms, value deeply the pedagogical project of being in front of students and working with students, but also believe to a certain degree that the work we do, at least I'll just speak for myself, for me personally, only really starts to matter if I can pair those experiences with public-facing experiences in the city. And actually, so that the work, the academic work that we do, which is rooted in rigorous research and analytical writing and publishing and all the things that we do, is at the same time has one eye on all of the other folks that we want to collaborate with and we want to reach with our work, right? I mean, you got to have that dialogue.
And instead of protecting the university spaces with, you know, gates and walls, it's thinking about things, thinking about our relationship to the city more porously.
That's right.
And thinking about that movement back and forth and through and in between. And I think that's one of my greatest projects in my research, in my teaching. I know it's part of yours, and, you know, I hope that the rest of our colleagues and students really appreciate that and will, you know, take that sort of sensibility to mind and to heart as well.
What's been your experience? We've both been teaching roughly the same amount of time.
Yeah,
roughly.
Been here since 2005.
Right.
So about the same.
Yeah,
time.
I mean, so yeah. I'm a finer vintage, a little bit finer vintage,
but a bit drier age.
A bit drier age, yes. But some would say I've gotten even better with it. Is what's changed for you? Like, what's been your experiences with your undergrads over the years about how they interact with popular culture? Has it changed a lot since you started teaching?
I think it's changed some. I think that you know, one of the things that's always really striking is that a lot of undergrads don't have as much time for popular culture as we imagine that they do.
Right.
Right. So it becomes more of a teaching exercise. That's totally surprised me. It's sort of like, you know, I assume that they're imbibing the shows and binging with as much fervor as we are. But actually,
so
they're busy studying and working and working hard and stuff, which is really great. I'm not encouraging any further, you know, binging on your part. But but I do think that also the student body has changed. I think that you know, one of the great things that USC has done is like a mentorship programs with folks who grow up in the community, and I think that that's really impacted the kind of culture of our classrooms. And there's a tremendous sense of curiosity, especially as, you know, downtown and adjacent areas change, that creates more flows between maybe the student body than there were in the previous decade when I started.
It's so funny, like the other day in our class, because it's come up a couple times, where I've said a version of this to them, or I've just looked at them and I've said, like, well, what do you guys watch? And what do you listen to? Because every time I'm like, oh yeah, you know that song or that artist, or that series, they're always like, nope. I'm like, what are you watching?
I know. And really had to alter my repertoire.
Yeah,
you know?
I know. And I feel like I'm keeping up, you know, I'm watching but I do think there's a lot of that kind of splintering of the media landscape where it's so atomized and it's so personalized that people are able to kind of hunt and peck and pick what they want.
Yeah.
And it I think for us as professors who deal with popular culture on a daily basis, forces us to stay on our toes.
Absolutely.
Right? Not just with the content, but also like the theoretical thing, you know, kind of aspects that we bring
ways
to the content.
Ways of thinking about
ways
stuff.
Of thinking. Exactly.
Yeah. Well, so actually, I think we probably should throw to questions in the last couple of minutes we have left. So do we have any
questions
coming in or, you know?
People just love what you're doing.
People just, we are so thorough that we have no questions.
Let me tell you what I hope to get out of this experience.
Yeah.
I just wanted someone to put the little balloons that go up on Facebook Live. Are they there? That's all I want.
Yeah.
Good
like,
night,
oh, the little balloons. Yeah.
I just wanted that. I wanted that.
Yeah. Well, thank you all for joining us. I'm Regis and this is Kathy Lee. And we've had a lovely time speaking with you today, and I hope you enjoyed our chat.
And USC is proof that dreams do come true. You can become Kathy Lee.
Yes, and you can become colleagues with Josh and Karen.
Right. And thank you to my dear friends at USC Annenberg for allowing us to hang out in this space and come at you live from USC.
Thanks, everybody. We're still live. Okay.
No, I'm gonna get